Yeah, let's cough a little. 58 caliber versus bowling pin. Is that what we named this video? Hickok 45 with a Civil War rifle, lots of black powder and lead. Okay, it's a happy day. And I'll get that out there. Yes, this is a 1853, pattern 53, P53 Enfield rifle musket. All right, used extensively in the Civil War, especially in the South, but also in the North to some degree. And it's an original, all right? Like me and John, it's an original. And let me tell you a little bit about it and shoot it, okay? Since you're here, if you hadn't shown up, I don't know how much more we'd shoot it. We've been shooting it, and it's a cool old gun. It, you know, this thing was used a lot, this particular gun. It's 1862. For those who can read, you can see it on the lock plate. And it's one of the trade guns, came out of Birmingham area in England. A lot of guns were made, they relied on the commercial gun makers. This has a 25-25 on it, which is further evidence it was, you know, a Birmingham gun. Birmingham, England, I think they don't pronounce it like they do in Alabama. I believe it's Birmingham, they say over there. And it's a 577, you know, roughly 58 caliber. And this was, this firearm is a recent purchase. It was, yeah, I got it in Murfreesboro, a neat little Civil War shop down there. And it was bought out of an estate in Chattanooga. It had been in Chattanooga for a long time, for decades and decades. So it's almost assuredly a Confederate, you know, used rifle. Because for one thing, that's where it seemed to be located for a long time. And it also is one of those firearms that the South bought, purchased in big numbers from England, okay? So pretty cool. 1862, you can see it's not a museum piece. It's got the pitting, but it still works and has original parts. It's cool. It even got the nipple cover still with it and everything. And as you know, this is the exact kind of firearm I like because it's something I can shoot and not worry about it. Now, it may need a little upgrading. I'm not going to shoot it 1,000 times or anything. Well, I might over a period of years. But I noticed the musket caps are awfully loose on it and they blow out on every shot. So I'm not sure if someone replaced the nipple or what. I'm just shooting the standard load that they basically used back then. About 68 grains, I think, of double F was kind of a recommended charge behind the mini ball. And I'm shooting about 65 grains and I've not had any pressure problems other than the caps blowing. The nipple's kind of weird. And I'll show you when I take it off here. It's I'm not having one stick that badly. It's getting kind of dirty. And if you can tell, it's a little bit mushroomed. It's almost like somebody replaced it with a smaller nipple or something. Or maybe not. Maybe they were just a little smaller on this than the Springfield or the other reproduction guns. I don't know. But it works okay. The original sights and everything. Okay. But I've taken it all apart. It's pretty cool. It's got the markings. And some of these I'm still not 100% sure what they mean. I know on the butt plate you've got markings here that are like a 58 in the D, and then same on the stock, the 58, and those are kind of a variety of like unit numbers, you know, unit or arsenal stampings, proof marks, and that kind of thing. Just depends, and it means different things depending on the lot and all that, or the batch, you know, of rifles that were purchased, rifle muskets that were purchased. So I'll load it while I'm yakking. How's that? So again, this was widely used. This and the Springfield that you've seen, you know, hopefully videos we've done on it, were the two most widely used rifles, muskets, you know, in the Civil War. Okay, I think pretty safe in saying that. And the Springfield was used most extensively in the North, although there were some of those in the South, battlefield pickups and whatever, because it was manufactured, you know, by the North. And as I'm talking here, I'll try not to dry ball. And then the South, you know, didn't have all the industry that the North had. And so they didn't have quite the firearm supply when the war broke out. And boy, they beat footed to England. They sent a fellow by the name of Major Caleb Hughes over there. And he quickly, you know, bought up guns and got contracts in, you know, around London and Birmingham for a lot of firearms, as many as he could find. And so these things were shipped, you know, back to the South, and the South ended up with a lot of the British Enfields. Okay, the pattern 53, this one right here. And there were different variations of it, need I tell you that? There always are, right? And this one, it seems like the balls I'm using are a little small as I put them in, but they go in just fine, and they seem plenty accurate for the shooting I've done so far, okay? Even though I have to adjust, and I'll talk about that when I sight the bullet. So you see, it doesn't just fall all the way down there, okay? And the bore looks decent, you know, it's not new, of course. 1960, 1862, it wouldn't be a perfect bore. If it were, it would be something that was never used, I guess, okay? So, let's cap it. We've got the powder over there. And take a shot. Now, the thing I have to adjust for is elevation. You know, Kentucky is really good to us. They allow us to use their windage when we need to. I don't know about elevation. I guess it's okay to use Kentucky elevation as well, because it does print a little bit high, which is understandable. I think, though, I can hit that 2-liter right there. Let's start with something easy. And I think that's what these guns were designed for, right? Okay. And I always repeat, because I don't get in too big a hurry. Nobody's shooting at me. And I like to get it cleared out before I reload. Put it up here again for a second. But the date and the tower, that's typical of, you know, this genre, these firearms that came under these contracts back to the Confederacy, and so many of them. Now, the tower indicates it was proofed by the, or checked, approved by the Tower of London or their branch in Birmingham, England. They had a branch there and to make the final approvals on all this. Those were mainly the guns they were making for England. And they didn't, you know, their government really didn't want to be furnishing a lot of guns to the South, I guess, or even the North. I don't know. They wanted to kind of stay out of it and stay neutral. So most of these firearms that were purchased were from the gun trade over there, especially in Birmingham. There were a lot of families been making these firearms for a long time. And I guess it was a little bit like what we do over here and have done before, rather, like with M1 Carbine or even the Garands. Various firearms have different companies that can make them for the U.S. government, you know. And then Springfield Armory, of course, was making them too, the government arsenal. And you sort of had that kind of thing with the I guess it, what was it called, the London Armory, you know, made a lot of them. But then there were all these other companies there right close to London that made them as well, in London and Birmingham, and they were making kind of the same guns. And they all didn't have interchangeable parts, though. I'm assuming this one does not, because it wasn't, I don't think, made for the government. This was one of the contract guns. But I'm not going to be changing a lot of parts. But it's kind of the basics of all that, and I'm still studying that. I've always liked the Enfield. My first Civil War replica was an Enfield. You've seen it. We've shot it a lot, because I just like the looks of them, you know, the brass and everything, better really than the Springfield in a lot of ways, but although they're both pretty cool. And they have a reputation for being really high-quality firearms, okay? So this is cool because it's original, and it there are different indications. I read, too, that the fact that the butt plate doesn't fit perfectly. I read where somebody was writing, said that that's an indicator of a Birmingham gun right there, that the butt plate, they extended just a little bit. It looks like your stock shrunk a little bit. And of course, the markings, the 25-25 indicates the caliber, as I said, and the Birmingham guns, you know, indicated that. And there's other evidence, too. So it's pretty cool, and the parts are there, and it works. I don't think the ramrod is original with it, but it's I think period correct. It's the correct ramrod, but I think well, I don't know, you know, obviously there'd be lots of opportunities to have those lost or different ones, you know, stuck in there, but there's no serial number on it or anything to even know. And I don't know if this company that made this one actually serial numbered it. So there you go. Let me load him up again. Okay, haven't loaded it, right? Okay, don't want a dry ball, you know what that is. Don't want to double load it or anything like that, because you just never know. These were made from about 1853 to 67, And then there's in service there for whatever, up until about 1871, I think. And you know what happened in the early 1870s? Come on now, tell me. Cartridges, right? So then we got away from the muzzle loaders about that time. And they were used during that period of time in various wars, the Crimean War, our Civil War, extensively. And I read they were used in the New Zealand land wars. It was kind of an internal revolution of some sort there in New Zealand. I wasn't there at the time, but I can believe it. And a reputation for just being really good rifles, rifle muskets, right? They are rifled, of course. All right, but they are musket length. They're kind of a holdover. Used by both North and South. Come on down there. There we go. I got that rod marked, which is always wise. Again, that's the thing about black powder muzzle loaders. I could double charge. You can't do that with modern powder. I could accidentally put two helpings of powder in there and then ram the ball in, and it wouldn't be catastrophic at all. Okay, I'd get a little more recoil, but it just, whatever powder doesn't burn, just blows out the barrel. But the most important thing, again, is that you get the ball down on the powder. Okay, all right, we're at half cock. Now, I have shot it, like I was saying, I need some Kentucky elevation. I can see the sight best when I have it set for 200 yards. See, I've got it on two there. If I put it down on one, it's hard to get my face down on it as well. So I really like the feel of it on two, but it does, you know, I have to allow for the elevation, right? Because that's the gong, for example, is 80 yards. I've never had that question, how far is the gong, right? So if I hold under it, I can generally hit it. Let's see. Oh, that's a sweet sound. I should be able to see it. It's such a big old chunk of lead. I think I did. Yeah. Oh, man. It's such a neat piece of history to be able to shoot one of these at something that doesn't shoot back. That's the coolest part of it. You know, and as I said, you know, it's got the slings, not really swiveled, but sling attachments. I don't have a sling for it. I might get one, I don't know. And then your nipple cover here, so you don't lose it. And the fellow I bought that from said that was original. You can buy those, you know, if you lose it, somebody makes them. That fits over there, and then the hammer down. And that would be handy. It would keep, what would it do? It would keep moisture out, wouldn't it? It'd protect your nipple, and you could walk around with this thing loaded. And then, if you're hunting or whatever, I guess, and you know you're about to get some game, you could take it off, put the cap on there. I don't think you can really put the cap on too well with that. Yeah, that won't work. But it protects the nipple, and that's pretty handy. The little musketoon I have, the reproduction of the Enfield musketoon, has that. Of course, it's a reproduction. Nice gun. But it doesn't, you know, it's not perfect. Look at that. You got a little, the pitting, the marks. And that's what's cool about these, though. You can just think about, look at those imperfections and the marks. Like that one, like those right there. That was a guy in camp in 1863, I think, at Chickamauga before the battle. You can see those where somebody's bayonet or something was banging against that. That makes sense? Nah, but it could have been. It just could have been. You know, if only they could speak. We always say that, don't we? But you just don't know where all those markings came from. There's a bunch up here. It's been banged on and a little pitting, but it's still good and shootable, and gets all dirty, cleans up just like, not like a new one, but it cleans up, and it's got pretty wood in it. So pretty cool. I like it. Okay, here I am talking. Did I load it? No, I don't think I did. Here's what you do when you're not sure. That's why you mark your ramrod. Now, these are so much easier to load with, so I typically don't use this unless I'm out in battle. I've got my mark right there. That tells me that's about where that should be once I load. Oop, nothing in there, see? So if I happen to forget, get to yakking or something, or you, whatever you do, you don't have your system down correctly, and so I guess I'll load it. The other thing you can do is, okay, I know there's not a ball in here, I didn't load it. Maybe I put powder in, because powder doesn't take much room, and you pack it down when you stick that in there. So I could turn it upside down just to make sure, no powder. Pretty sure there's none, but what I try to do, the one thing I try to do, is do both at the same time. So I'm likely, if I'm gonna have a problem, if I forget, it's gonna be either totally loaded or not loaded at all. It's not gonna probably just have powder in it, because I try to make sure that when I do the powder, I go ahead and put the ball on in there, okay? So let's do that. And as you know, from my, if you want to see how these old things are actually loaded in the field, check out the first 1863 Springfield video, because I actually went through the trouble of learning how to make the paper cartridges, and I used them in that video, okay? So try to remember to just grab a ball when I lay that down so I don't get out of sync there. Ram him on down. I love these Civil War rifles. I'm so glad I got into them, because they're easier to load than a Hawken. I lost it in a burglary, and it, in a way, it was a blessing in disguise. It got me into these things. All right, we're on half cock. I don't want to go off half cock now. Okay. Well, let's shoot the hit the gong. Let me take a shot at a ram. All right, now I may have more trouble with this. Like I say, I need to borrow some Kentucky elevation if they'll lend it to me. And I won't be able to tell where it went, but you will if I miss, probably. And I'll shoot that at the one on the right, the top right one. And that's the one that fell. That's always good when the one you're shooting at is the one that fell. All right. This might be my new hunting rifle. No, wait a minute, I don't hunt. It could be. I mean, isn't that interesting? I mean, maybe it's not as much to you as it is me, but you folks that hunt deer or whatever, you could take one of these things, over 150 years old, or whatever, 1863, it comes out to be, get my calculator out. And you know, figure out where it hits, and you could deer hunt. Now, you may not pick something off at 400 yards, just depends, but you could take an old gun like this that's actually worn and use it in the field. You know, it still does what it did in the 1860s. It puts a big chunk of lead out there with some accuracy, quite a bit more accuracy than most people realize, to tell you the truth. So, pretty cool. Don't have to convince you that I like these, do I? You know that by now, unless you're a new viewer. You might be. If you are, be sure you go back and look through. If you think these are interesting at all, and you're not bored to tears already, like most of our viewers are, go back and you know how to search a channel, hopefully, because these things are not in a playlist. Lost track of that long ago. Look at, what was it, FAQ video 54, if you don't know how to search somebody's YouTube channel. And just plug in there, muzzle loader, you know, Civil War, whatever. And you'll pull up all the things we've done in muzzle loading and these Civil War rifles. Done several videos with the reproductions I have, those handguns right there, and with the 1863 Springfield, again, which is the counterpart pretty much to the Enfield. I just looped some of these up here. I was shooting before the video. I was shooting yesterday or day before, whichever it was. And so I got some fresh lube on these. It's nice and messy. As I always point out, if you don't like messy, you would not like these. Because look at my hands. That's what you get. But it washes off just fine. Let me smear it on my face. That's what I ought to do. Okay. Take off the old cap. And this is heaven for me. I think you know. Let me go ahead and shoot the, I don't know how many times we'll shoot it. I've got enough targets up here. I could have a Glock shooting here if I wanted. I'll go ahead and put one on that cinder block. Okay. Okay, I got him. Oh, we're a little bit to the left. And I pulled it left. It's kind of an interesting day because there's not a lot of breeze. The smoke just kind of hangs, hovers. although it's a clear fall day. You shoot one of these, you know, in the summer when it's humid and there's no movement, I mean, it'll just really hang badly. Can't imagine what a Civil War battle would look like on a hot, humid day with no breeze. Cannon and these things going off by the thousands. You'd literally not be able to see across there, you know, at what you're shooting at, I would think. So, pretty cool. Get the old ramrod from coming out. I took that cap off. Okay, yeah, cruddy they get, but they clean up just fine. Not a problem at all. Not a problem. Anything else about it? You see, you got some of your like proof markings, cartouches there, and a lot of that is just like who does the inspection, and some of them had more meaning than others. I think I was talking about the tower. They put the tower on all these, but in some ways it may be a little bit bogus. It wasn't necessarily inspected by the official inspectors, the government inspectors, you know, at the Tower of London Armory or even their branch in Birmingham. Don't know for sure, but it's just the same pattern made by them. It's kind of like 1911s or anything made by different folks there, and that's where most of them came from. The vast majority of the 1853 Enfields that were imported into this country for the Civil War were like this, from the trades, the gun makers there, the commercial gun makers. I think I said that already. Because again, the government didn't want to get too involved and ship a bunch of their guns. But there were so many people making them, you know, it was not a problem for us to buy them from the gun makers. And like I said, I was raised in a border state, you know, northern Kentucky. So the Civil War wasn't a big piece of my culture growing up. So when I moved down here to Tennessee, you know, it's a bigger deal. It's an interesting deal, kind of like SEC football. You know, I wasn't into that either necessarily. So it's a different world, and all these Civil War battlefields down in this area. It just it started to interest me more and more, but. I forgot where I was going with that thought, but because I said we. But the South, the Confederacy, once they fired on Fort Sumter and the war started, like I say, they realized we need arms, we need small arms in a hurry. And so they sent Caleb Hughes, I guess that's how you pronounce his last name, H-U-S-E, over there. And he deserves a lot of credit, as you'll read from the Southern writers, that if they hadn't have done that and gotten all those big contracts on all these infields early on, then it could have been really bad, because there were, I think, around a million of these things imported. Now, some of them were to the North, but most of them came to the Confederacy. And to get them over here, you know, the war was going on, and there was a blockade, a Union blockade, around all the southern coast. They had to ship them, I read, in like British ships down into Bermuda and that area, Nassau. And then they'd put them on smaller steam boats that were lighter and they could move faster, and they would just run the blockades, blockade runners, they called them. And then they could get them in past the blockade into this country. And a lot of them came in that way. So, and this one right here, probably, yeah. Interesting history, and it's just fascinating. That cinder block didn't react enough. I'm gonna hit him in the center if I can. I forgot my ears, but I'm gonna go ahead and shoot. Yep, then I overreacted. These guns are long barrels, and it's black powder. They're not quiet. There's no suppressor on them. They don't really hurt your ears. You still want to wear ear protection, don't you? Okay. Nice. Oh, the sheep. I got to put one on the target. We'll shoot another 2-liter or something here. But I don't want you to miss dinner. I don't want John to miss dinner. He likes to eat like me. I like it too well. I'm shooting 2F powders, you see there. You can use 3F. You just want a different, little bit less of it kind of thing. You can shoot whatever load you want, actually. I just try to duplicate a load that's comparable to what they actually used. I mean, if I'm going to pretend I'm in the Civil War, shooting a Civil War replica or an original like this, I want to kind of duplicate it all the way as much as possible. shooting the mini balls, and you know, just do it. One thing I noticed about this one, whoops, you don't have to clean it after every 3-4 shots. It doesn't seem to change, you know. And I'd read that the type of rifling that these Enfields have lend themselves to that pretty well. So that's kind of nice. It doesn't get all clogged up, and after 3 shots, you know, it takes, you know, 3 men to get that ramrod down, to get the ball down. It doesn't seem to change. So that's pretty cool. Oh yeah, I was gonna shoot the target over here. We'll probably just put one on it. I'll put my ears on this time. Let's see, if I hold kind of on the bottom of the black, it ought to be somewhere near the middle. Okay, and it's got a hole in it. That's all you wanted, one hole, right? I could shoot this thing all day, and again, that's kind of what I do. I was a little bit late getting out here today with it and getting ready. But typically when we're doing a video on one of these, like I said in the last video we did, that's all I do. It's all I shoot that day. And I'll get it out and just plink around for an hour, two, mess with it, maybe go eat lunch. Because we're set up for muzzle loader, and that's what we're doing today. So we're not doing anything else. I'm not going to put my hands on an Ed Brown or a Glock. All right, powder. Powder first, right? And again, you load from a powder measure. If there were a spark, an ember down in there, you don't want a hand grenade there handy. Just the 60 grains of powder in this burn, that's all. And you'd be fairly safe. So you have to be careful. Do it as you do with any shooting. My ears off. Do it at your own risk. Just like driving a car. There's risk, but not much. Not much. Okay. Here we go. That was a little harder. I might have spoke too soon there. Spoken too soon. I have to run a cleaning patch through there. All right. Why don't we try one of those 2 liters at the, well, you know what? I think it's more fun to shoot the gong. Let's put another one on it. Try to. I love that. I love it. Popped it. No quite. Now you can't see it. If you've ever shot muzzle loaders, black powder, you know why, what I'm talking about. The smoke clouds everything. That's one of the fun things about the steel. You can hear it though. It's no problem to hear it. All right. We'll take a couple more and then maybe let you go. I don't know. And of course, these, you would think, I have these. You know, I have several of these. The 1860. This is the handgun that someone, or the 1851 Navy Colt in the South, they'd probably more likely be carrying the Navy One. Colt had been out since 51, of course, and very, very popular gun. This is the gun that Hickok carried, two of these. So that would have been, with a variety of others too, but you'd have seen more of those in the South because it wasn't necessarily just a Union gun, whereas this was the 1860 Army was, you know, issue to the Union. I don't know if the 51 Navy was ever issued or not to either side, really, but there were so many of them around by then that it was fairly common. And this is the 44 caliber 1860 Army. So yeah, there have been some of those in the South too, of course. And so they've been carrying maybe one of these pistols or some others, a variety of others. They even made some of these in the South. I think some of the 51 Navies too. But a percussion, and for some reason, as someone who likes pistols more than rifles, typically, you'd think I'd be more interested in shooting those when I wanted to come out and burn some black powder. But the rifles, for some reason, with black powder appeal to me more as far as just shooting them. They're a little simpler, as you can kind of tell. Yep, I didn't clean it, did I? Yeah, we'll try it one more here. Like, I shoot too much more anyway. You know what, if there's anything I've failed to tell you about these things that I haven't over the years, Well, that went down even easier. Yeah, we're in good shape. Yeah, cool. If you've never tried black powder, you owe it to yourself. It is fun. And it gets filthy, but it doesn't matter. It does not matter. Ah, that gong sounded good. Now we'll try a 2-liter here, maybe. All right. I'll just shoot that blue one, or at it. I think the windage is right on, so it's really a matter of elevation. And of course, pulling the trigger at the right time. That must not have been a good hit. I wounded him, I guess, somewhere. I couldn't see through the smoke. Oh, man. Might have caught the bottom of it. I might have held too low. If this range, I bet I did. I held too low. I'm used to having to hold low because I've got it set for 200 yards. One more shot, and I'll let you go. Anything else I hadn't told you about this thing? So again, oops, I don't want to change that. Again, this one was in an estate in the Chattanooga area for decades, and you know, it's pretty much. You're never 100% sure, but it was a Confederate used firearm. There's just so many reasons why it would have been, but you never know. You never know for sure. So you don't want to make claims, outlandish claims that you can't prove. Like, oh, this was Robert E. Lee's personal rifle, musket. I know for a fact, because my great-great-grandfather told me. All kinds of stories like that come up. I make those up myself for my Colt single actions. I claim that Wyatt Earp carried every single one of them. All right. Big old mini ball. And when they first started, these came out in, I don't know, for a period of years. Actually, probably in the U.S. as they were used by the Confederacy and the North, they were using these grooved mini balls, but... I also read that they were really used early on with the, was it the Pritchard ball, something like that, which was like the mini ball, but I found one's not too gooey, except it didn't have the grooves in it. And it was like this, had the hollow base. So he actually, I believe he's the one who came up with the hollow base. And then I guess Manet took it further and had the grease grooves, and I don't know. Well, look at my hands, isn't that lovely? Isn't that just lovely? See, by my wife's out of town, I just go grab her face. I scare her whenever I come into the house with hands like that. All right, now there I was talking, see, and that's not good. You probably say, yeah, you're right, Hickok, shut up. I put the ball in, okay? It's easy to forget. So, well, I always want to notch your ramrod there. Okay, last shot. And... what should I do for my last shot? Why don't we just, you know, there were probably some cowboys in the 1860s. There were a lot of cowboys. So let's just take out a desperado. Let's take out this one we never shoot as much. All right, Mr. Desperado. I bet that hurt. Almost 500 grains of lead. That had to hurt a lot. So... pattern 53, 1853 Enfield, a really fine rifle, and it's the one you see, I guess, in most of the reproductions. There are reproductions of this this 1853 Enfield. The actually the two-band model I have, this reproduction, is it was used by the Navy mostly, basically the same gun but in a shorter version, still pretty long. Then I have the musketoon. That shorter version I was just mentioning is, I think, was used by the Navy, and anybody that had one liked it because this is pretty long. But most troops had these long, this and the Springfield, they're just long, 39-inch barrel. You know? And then the musketoon, the shortest one, was cavalry loved it, artillery people, and all three of them shoot just fine. You know, I would have liked to have the musketoon if I was in battle. That would have been fine. Just give me the musketoon. It has, I think, a 24-inch barrel. It's not like there are Derringers or something. You know, I mean, it's probably this long. So it wasn't bad at all. In fact, I think I shoot it the best of all the muzzleloaders I have, the Musketoon. It's a really cool rifle, even though it's a reproduction. So I highly recommend, if you've not tried this before, I know I'm always trying to sell you on revolvers. I'm also always trying to sell you on muzzleloaders if you've never tried it. Don't be afraid of it. Just study up on it and look at our videos. I do most things correctly, I think. I've never had an accident or blown up a gun or myself. You know, I haven't blown up myself. I haven't blown an arm off yet. I promise I have not. It's just a lot of fun. And if you enjoy history and taking a trip back into history, it's another way to take that voyage, get you a muzzleloader, especially if it's a replica of some firearm that was actually made. There are reproduction muzzleloaders. They're really not a replica of anything. And they're, you know, just like their other modern lever guns and things. They're lever guns, but they were come up with in 1950 or something. They're not an old design. So I like the reproductions of firearms that were actually used, you know, back in the day. Reproductions of this, for example. So, and I didn't show you the sight, but you got the ladder sight. You can put it up and crank that up and out to, what was it, 300, 400 yards, see? So pretty cool. And that's the original sight. And that's the original dirt and grit on it. So nice. If I see you at a meet and greet, I'll make sure my hands look just like that so I can shake your hand, pat you on the back. Life is good. Since I'm still here, let me thank SDI for all their help. SDI is a fully accredited online gunsmithing school. Check them out at sdi.edu. We'd also like to thank Bud's Gun Shop and Federal Premium for all of their support. You can find us on Full 30 also now, and you can find the links to our Facebook pages and the other YouTube pages in the description of any video. So I invite you to check out the description in every video or any video. You'll find what you need to know, and you'd better do it.